it brings me great pleasure to get out of your way and introduce the gangster of comedy, the one and only Capone!
Oh! Y'all better get excited. This is the last time y'all gonna hear good rap. Y'all remember this, don't y'all? Oh, that's my song. This right here, this when we were really partying right here. Go ahead, let me hear. Everybody, shake your body. We get a 3-3 shoe, let it party. Cut that off. I'm having a flashback of when we used to have a good time. Now all we hear is, you don't call me no more. My name is Drake. What Drake said, you used to call me on my cell phone. And we listening to that like that was rap. Well, we're about to start this show. We're going to have some fun. I'm going to make you laugh. And my comedians are going to make you laugh. And if we don't, it's okay. We got our checks already. You might as well loosen up. This is the time to have fun. Then we go back to business tomorrow. Some people came here just for business. I could see it in your faces. You're determined. When Isaiah Thomas was speaking, you was clapping. You was jumping up. And you realized that you're not in business yet. It's good to have an idea. Last year, I talked about women because I wanted to honor my mother. This year, I'm going to talk to the men because this is Black Men Excel. Now, I'm a Black Man Excel. I got a button. I don't know how I got it, but I got one. Some people haven't acknowledged me yet, but I'm letting everybody know that is my button. If you're missing a button, you better come next year to try to get back into the position of becoming a Black man excelling. We're looking good. Everybody's not here yet. So we are going to try to keep the pace of the show to where everybody's having a good time sitting down. This place is a little different. I got lost twice. But it's beautiful. Nice rooms, very clean. The staff is beautiful. They speak Spanish. The bad part is when you ask them directions, they don't know. I think this whole building is new because I don't know where you go, but your room. I was like, you know where 4281 is at? No, but try your key. If it worked, that's it. If your key is over there, that's your room. Don't tell nobody, I tell you that. Thank you. You want to give me water now after I'm dehydrating? Come on, let everybody see you. You don't want nobody to see you? Yeah, I'm about to pass out. Y'all got all kinds of good soda. Okay, that's all I needed. We got a lot more stuff for y'all. More business stuff tomorrow. Then we're going to party a little bit tonight. Please don't get too tipsy that you can't get up tomorrow for the events. Because a lot of y'all wake up, you don't look like yourself. A couple of women in here, I want to talk bad about you, but your wig was not on properly. And some of the things y'all have to stop doing, ladies. This is New Year coming up. The eyelashes have got to go. They too long. Some of them look like bangs on your face. One girl winked at me and put me to sleep, just washed my whole face. But everybody's sexy and grown and respectable. A lot of men in here with their wives. I've seen a couple of arguments start, I ain't gonna lie. Men is just starting for no reason when there's beautiful women. And we try not to look, but something is wrong with us. See, when a beautiful woman walked by, Something happens to us men where we stop, stare, and imagine. We done put a whole story into our vision of this beautiful woman. And you think your wife or your girlfriend don't know the type of woman you like. And we always get caught because we're not really intelligent. We turn around and your girl would say, do you see something you like? And instead of you being the man and saying, baby, I don't know what you're talking about, you will start an argument. That's why we don't go nowhere. Every time I turn around, you think I'm looking at somebody. Because you was. Now, women do the same thing. Oh, yes, they do the same exact thing. Women will see a gorgeous man, will look at him, have that same fantasy that you have, and you catch her, but she outsmarts you. Because as soon as you catch her, she will look at you and say, "Bae, don't he look like John that work on your job?" And here we go, "Oh, you right. You got good eyesight, baby." And she be like, I know. And we don't need to cheat, gentlemen. We got to stop. 2020, stop it. We can't do it. We too dumb. Men, we got to stop. They got cell phones. Women are walking up to us, seeing us on a date without our woman. Take a picture and send it right to your girl. Then we'll ask her, what should we do? Not men. See, women have a whole team. They have a woman to drive, another one to park the car, another one to get the kids, and guess who's setting it up? Her mother. The mother will take the phone call. Hello? Hi, Miss Jenkins, you seen Keisha? Oh, yes, baby, she went to the grocery store for me. She gonna be gone about 2 hours. Okay, tell her to call me when she come in. Oh, sure will. God is good. And hang up and call Keisha. He called. So what happened, Mom? Don't worry about it, baby. You got 2 hours. Get one in there for Mama. Not men, we don't have nothing. We don't even have friends to help us out. We get caught cheating, our whole regiment is messed up. Everything. We usually come home 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. We cheat, 1 o'clock in the morning. With an excuse, because your woman set you up. I was worried about you. Why you didn't call? Our all lives are the same. Baby, Sean got a raise. Sean got a raise and he wanted to celebrate. I was gonna call you, but my phone be dying. Sean got a raise and we went out and we got a couple of drinks and it was like 9 o'clock. And so we was walking and there was a bowling alley. And this way your girl set you right up. Oh, so you went bowling. And now you so stupid, you don't even realize you lying. Yeah, baby, you should have seen me. I was killing them on the bowling alley. Okay, so you good, huh? You can bowl. She's setting you right up. Yeah, about 4 strikes that night. Next morning, you go to work. She even cooked you breakfast. She gets up, calls Sean. She don't ask Sean no question. That's not her style. Hello, Sean. Hey, what's up, Keish? Listen, my uncle is doing a tournament. And the grand prize is $5,000. And I wanted to know if you wanted to join the team. $5,000? Well, what y'all got to do? Well, we putting a little bowling game together. Oh, damn. I ain't never been bowling. Thank you, Sean. That's how we get set up. That's how we get set up. I'm telling you right now. Men, we got to stop. We're not smart enough to cheat no more. We are not. These women got us beat. We do. They do all kinds of stuff to us. Everything. They make us love them. We make love. They ask us questions while we're making love. We don't know how to answer. And if you cheat and you lie, you might as well let the relationship go. Because she'll accept you back. But she's accepting you back to ask you questions. So what make this girl so special? Why did you do it? And sometimes, some men wake up in the middle of the night and catch they woman staring at them. 3 o'clock in the morning, she looking right at you. You wake up out of your sleep. Baby, what's wrong? Every woman answers the same. Nothing. So why are you up at 3 o'clock in the morning? Why? Is there a problem? When you was with her, it was 3 o'clock in the morning. So why is it a problem now? You was running around all freelancing, now you worried about time. See, men, we can't win. When your woman come in, I'm telling you right now, women have this power that they could do stuff to us, and we don't even know that we're doing it. You ever start an argument? Remember back in the days? Back in the days when a man would tell a woman, shut up, God damn it. And the woman would shut up. But them old men had like a technique with shut up. It was always that two-step. You better shut the hell up. That two-step was powerful. That two-step. Your mama shut up. Try to tell one of these women now, shut up. She would look at you like you had a third party. I'm tired of this. You're talking to me too much. Shut up. Shut up. Tell your mother to shut up. Now you mad. She hurt your feelings. You don't know what to say out your mouth. I thought you liked my mother. Now you mad. You're going to raise your voice. Every man used to have that scary voice. Not no more. We used to say something else. There's going to be some goddamn problems in here. I'm tired of this trifling ass. Now she go, oh. That little giggle means something. Oh, so now I'm trifling. I'm trifling. I'm trifling now. And then they do something, you don't know what happened. So I'm trifling. Wow. Wow. Now every man run behind her. Why you say wow? What does my wow mean? I'm telling you now. We got to stop, fellas. Got to grow up. Certain things change when we're getting older. When we're young, even young, making love was beautiful. Oh, it was beautiful. Everybody was beautiful. Ladies, I'm going to tell you a secret that you don't know. Men didn't really like to have sex. What we liked was the vision of sexual action in a mirror. You looking that way, and he looking at the mirror, and everything was just so beautiful. You didn't know because we was childish behind you. Doing all the childish stuff. And everything was nice. Everything was sexy back then. You looking that way, doggy style. Your stomach flat. His stomach flat. Oh, it was beautiful. It was a beautiful thing. The image itself was beautiful. After 35, 40, things change. Your stomach on the bed. His stomach on your ass. You looking at the mirror, you don't even recognize you. Who is that? You think the mirror turned into the window. What the hell? Is that us? You turn your back on you. That ain't me, got me. Yes. So we got a real powerful show. I am your host, Capone. I will touch on some of the things we talked about today, and we're going to have some fun. The comedians I got are hysterical. One thing is hard for us to do is not curse. So that's why I come up here and do a little bit and then watch them not curse and see how hard it is. Because everybody curse. Everybody. You don't realize how important a curse is until you can't do it. You cannot do it. Black people, it's been a long time that we wanted to curse. This was our power. Even as a little kid, you 4 years old, your brother tell you, get out my room. Get out my room. You said, stop hitting me, shit. The curse was the powerful part. Now, we couldn't curse no more in front of our parents until you got grown and your parents had to solidify it. But white people, y'all cursed early. I know it. I had my best friend was Billy, 10 years old. His mother, we won a baseball game. His mother put a sandwich in front of him and one in front of me. Billy looked at the sandwich and said, "Mom, I don't want this shit." I started shaking. I looked at Billy. I said, "Billy, you're going to get both of us beat." Billy said, "My mom knows I don't eat this shit." Billy's mother came and brought us two new sandwiches. I was messed the hell up. I said, "I can't wait to get home to try this." I was 10 years old. I said, she put my food in front of me. I said, "Mom!" And she just looked at me. I went from 10 to 4 like that. I said, ha, ha, ha. I said, "Ma, I'm going to eat all of this. I'm going to be the big boy. I swear to God, this is good." Black women, I'm telling you, my mother was a powerful woman. We were hood, too. She would hit me with everything. I've been knocked out 4 times at 10. One time, my mother picked up my sister and hit me. She was swinging and missing me. You know, my sister reached out, bow, knocked her out of me. All right. I think y'all ready. I wish y'all would turn off one of these lights. I feel like it's rotisserie. I'm going to be done tonight, baby. All right. So let's have some fun. This first brother I'm bringing to the stage, it's a lot of special guests here. First guy I'm bringing to the stage, he's actually one of my favorite guys now. He started as my opening act, got on the internet, blew up. Now I barely can reach him. You've seen him, he is funny. A lot of people see him on the internet but don't know he is actually a real star comedian. Please put your hands together for the incredible. Let's clap it up, please. Let's clap it up, let's clap it up. For my man, Mr. Shula King.
All right, cut it off. Cut. Thank you. Thank you. Y'all give it up for DJ such and such, whoever this is up here. I don't know your name, brother. I don't know. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, I'm glad we're all in here. I can tell you now, that stiff clapping that y'all just did, we gonna do this over. This ain't gonna work. This ain't no corporate event. I might slip up and cuss. I'm gonna have fun tonight because this might be the last time I'm here. I usually mess up. I'm just going to say it. But he said, y'all, give it up for Shula King. He big me up to be a whole lot, and I can just look at your faces. Yeah, he said, y'all, give it up for Shula King. Some of y'all was just looking at me like this. Well, I ain't never seen him on nothing. Well, hell, I ain't never seen none of y'all on nothing. So I came out here in one of my best suits for y'all. I look nice. I wore some sexy stuff for y'all, and my mama done hemmed up my pants. I ain't come out here for y'all to mess up my self-esteem. So what's getting ready to happen? Such and such, just follow. No, listen, hold on, such and such. Wait a minute. What we gonna do? I'm gonna reintroduce my damn self. And when I do, y'all better clap in here, make some noise like you know who I am. And like this a Netflix special. You too, I see you. When I say y'all clap like y'all know why, you like, I ain't clapping. Yes, you will. I burn this hotel down. If you don't clap, I'll kill everybody in here if you don't clap. Oh yeah, that's right, yeah. You, sir. You, okay. See, y'all ready? Hey, don't mess it up. I'm not playing. I fight everybody in here, don't play. Because I'm going to do this reintroduction, we going to have fun. Just want you to loosen up, okay? Loosen the collars up, such and such, when I point at you. When I point at you, such and such, you play the song, okay? This ain't trigonometry. All I want you to do, just press the button. When I point at y'all, I'm going to tell y'all when to make noise. I'm going to point at you, just make noise. We going to have fun, relax. Capone said earlier, hell, I done got paid already. So if y'all don't want to have fun, it's on you. Okay, I'm over here. You can't see me. Don't look. Oh, okay, they turned the light. Okay, you're helping me out. Thank you. All right, here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, this brother hails from Sumter, South Carolina. I know nobody in here knows where the hell that is, and that's okay. What I want you to do is put your hands together, make some noise, make some noise, make some noise, make some noise. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Shula King. Hey, ain't nobody tell you to stop. Come on. All right, cut it off. Thank you, such and such. That's what I'm talking about. Yes, I'm happy to be here. I'm a small town brother from Sumter, South Carolina. Some of y'all was clapping. I said that. Somebody know where that is? Y'all know where Sumter is? Yes. Yes, we are represented. Thank you. Y'all make me feel good because I live in Atlanta now, and I like being in Atlanta, you know. But I'm telling you now, my hometown, my small hometown of Sumter, South Carolina, got luxuries that Atlanta don't have. I know y'all looking at me like, what the hell they got? That Atlanta don't have. Well, Atlanta's a good city, like Atlanta, all that. But what Sumter has that Atlanta does not have is this one luxury that I appreciate. And that is, whatever something looks like, that's what the hell it is. Yeah, see, Atlanta ain't got that. Some of y'all know what the hell I'm talking about. I ain't got no issue with nobody. Be what you want to be. You do what you want to do, but all I'm saying is, look, I can look down at you. Right now, lights is low, I can look down at you, ma'am, and I can tell that's a woman. I come down off the stage, walk right up to you, guess what? That's still gonna be a woman. Don't work like that in Atlanta. You might see something that look like something, and it ain't, damn it, that. And I ain't, like I said earlier, I don't have an issue with nobody being the way they are. If you gay, be gay, more power to you. I don't care nothing about that. I don't have no issue with nobody being gay, but damn it, I don't like being tricked. Them brothers down there will trick your ass. Brother be 6'5", 350 pounds, all muscles and tattoos, dreadlocks and gold teeth. You walk by with respect. What's going on, player? His ass. Hey, little chocolate. Nah, I done got mad. My name ain't no damn little chocolate now. You stop calling me that. Ladies, I know y'all get frustrated as you're dealing with the, you know, little down low brothers and stuff. You know, it's an issue. You know, like I said, ain't got no issue with nobody being gay. But damn, don't, you know, don't be tricking these ladies. Ladies, I know y'all get frustrated. You be dealing with a dude 2-3 years, come to find out he only messing with you to get to your brother. Uh-huh, struck a nerve. It's all right. It's all right, ladies. It's okay. Let me tell you something. I'm here to educate. Consider yourselves lucky, ladies, because I'm here. And I messed around and found a clue to let you know whether you're dealing with a down low brother or not. Yeah, look at the women paying attention like hell now. Yes, it is a clue that I found that lets you know. Now, I'm going to tell you now, I'm going to forewarn you, okay? When I tell you what the clue is, everybody in here going to look at me like I'm crazy as hell. Yes, you are. Soon as I say what it is, all y'all gonna look at me like, what? Then I'm gonna show you, and you gonna see exactly what the hell I'm talking about. Okay? Here's the clue. If you see your man's bottom row of teeth too much, yep, didn't I say y'all was gonna do that? Look at your faces. Look at your faces. Now, I'm gonna show you. You're gonna see exactly what the hell I'm talking about. Ladies, pay attention. I know they say when you're talking to your man, look him in the eyes, because the eyes are the window to the soul. Let me tell you something. The hell with them eyes, okay? Look in his mouth. Look in his mouth. That mouth is gonna tell you everything you need to know. Watch how he is pronouncing and enunciating words when y'all are having a conversation. Watch that. And look for this hand. Look for that bottom row. Matter of fact, y'all don't even need to be having a conversation. Just if he's sitting in the room watching TV, paying, just minding his own business. Walk in the room, ask him a simple question. Watch this here. Just walk in the room and say, baby, what time did you say you was going to the gym? If he look at you and go, by 6. Look around, see who ain't laughing. Now, for the rest of the night, all the women gonna be trying to sneak and look in their man mouth and shit. The brother's gonna get all defensive. Don't be looking in my damn mouth, y'all. You ain't never seen my bottom row of teeth. I don't know what you're talking about. You left around and let that big-eyed bastard get you in trouble. But you gonna leave me? You ain't leaving nobody. I ain't with it. I'm a grown man. I got a washer and a dryer. I'm tripping off that. That'll be an argument on the way back to the room. What you looking in my mouth for? And if you leave me, where you going? You better not leave me before we pay off this house. I know that. That's real, man. Cause y'all don't know, man. I know some of y'all might know me from social media or something like that. And, you know, a lot of y'all probably don't know me. That's cool. But being here lets me know that my career is on the right trajectory. Yes, being amongst you people, it does let me know when I'm doing something right, you know. And I always vow to anybody I'm standing on stage in front of, I make a promise to all the people, you know, I let y'all know that if I blow up and become the star that y'all want me to be, I promise all of you, I'm not messing with none of them Kardashian heifers. I'm sorry, is it me or do they ruin every man they come close to? We can just go down the list. I'm sorry. All right. Am I tripping? Just let's go down the list. Was Bruce Jenner? It's Caitlyn now, right? They got him looking like a golden girl. This dude was on the Wheaties box one time, throwing a discus. He was an Olympian. He was the that was the only average white man doing stuff that the average white man wasn't even supposed to be doing. Ain't no average white man supposed to outrun an African in a foot race. He did it. Africans couldn't even believe it. Because they was all the way in front. They was winning. Next thing you know, he passed them. The African was like, what was that? Was that the white man that just passed here? No, to hell with the rest. Take me to the hospital. Lamar Odom, they got him too. Y'all remember Lamar? Yeah, number one sixth man in the NBA, was Lakers, 6'9", healthy as hell. Wasn't nothing wrong with Lamar. Nothing. Nothing at all. He didn't have a DUI, a UTI, nothing. Messed around and got with one of them heifers. Started smoking crack. Don't act like I'm lying. He was, yes, he was. Remember, it came on the TV and said Lamar Odom was in Las Vegas at a bunny ranch. Yeah. Doing drugs and having sex with prostitutes until he slipped into a coma. Now, I'm gonna be honest with you. The part about him doing drugs and having sex with prostitutes was not my issue. I didn't care about that part. I wasn't judging, because I know probably for some of y'all that's just a good weekend. My issue came in where they said he was paying the women $75,000 and $80,000 for sex. Yeah, 80,000. Look at the women. 75, 80,000. You mean to tell me I'm sitting on 80 grand in this month? Women start doing the calculation. Hold up now. I can go to Vegas and just get 7 people. I pay off these student loans. Buy myself a damn Chick-fil-A, girl. We need to get to Vegas. I can get my life together in one weekend. 75, 80 grand, no wonder he passed out. Shoot, I ain't had no $80,000 worth of sex. If you add up all the hotel rooms, the condoms, the Plan B pills, I know it don't add up no 80 grand. What? Stop me when I start lying. Let me know how much time I got, because you know I'll stay up here. I'm not drunk yet. Well, I'm just saying, man, Then they got our boy, Kanye. They got him. Yeah, they got him. Yes, they, because I knew they was going to get him when he ran up on the little white girl at the MTV Awards. Remember? Taylor, Trailer, whatever. You know what I'm talking about. Got drunk as hell, ran up there, and snatched the microphone out of her hand. And well, I'm going to let you finish, but Beyonce has one of the greatest videos all time. I knew it then. I said, they going to get him. And they did. But my thing was, try that on a sister. No, you ain't tough because you done did that to her. He knew just who to do that to, the little timid, quiet white girl. And it really ain't got nothing to do with her being white because we all know pink would have beat his ass. Yes, she would have. Mom, I'm just saying, try it on the sister. Run up on Patti LaBelle. Or Anita Baker or somebody. Or just a regular Shakima. Yeah, Shakima would have just cussed him slam out. I can't even say none of the stuff Shakima would have went. You know how that would have went. And this is her first time out the project. She probably would have had a lime green, aqua blue hair with the sequins lime green dress with aqua blue eyebrows and stuff. She'd have been sitting there. This is her first time getting an award. And then they mess around and call the award for the album of the year, Shakima Franklin. You know how she just came with that? Oh, my God. I got an award, bitch. Wet. You know good and hell well you can't run up on her. One thing y'all need to know about me, and I'm going to start wrapping it up. Yes, I am a comedian, but something most people don't know about me, I am also a licensed funeral director. Yeah, I am. That's not a joke, man. No, I mean, I figured I might as well bring it up. We here at the Black Enterprise function. I want to let y'all know I'm black and enterprising too. My family owns Williams Funeral Home in Sumter, South Carolina, and we've been in business for over 75 years. Yes, that's true. That's right. That's right. I'm excelling too. And I know most people, they find out I'm a funeral director. They y'all love to ask me questions. Like, you don't never be scared. Y'all love to ask me this one. This is my favorite one. Ain't no dead person ever tried to grab you. Let me be clear. If I go get a dead body and I get him and we are together, he is in my presence. And if he moved for any reason on his own, that's my last damn day at work. I'm retired. Only way you gonna find me, you follow that trail of piss down the block. That's it. And I remember the first time I went to pick up a dead body with my father, you know, because he's the one that taught me everything I know about the funeral business. And you know, usually when, you know, like on television, when the father's bringing the son into the family business, there's a talk, you know, he says, well, son, you're getting to be a big boy, and, you know, it's time to start doing things that big boys do. And I want you to come with me into the family business and pay attention to everything I say and everything I do, because one day, this is going to be your responsibility. That was not the talk I got. Only thing my father said to me was, hey, I need you to help me do something. That was it. That's all he said. Bruh, you a grown man, dog. You a grown man. Not a lot of stuff scare you, okay? As a black man, you can't afford to be scared. You done seen too much, right? You understand? But if I call you and I say, hey, need you help me do something, you grown. But if I call you and say that, you would appreciate it if that something that I need you to do is picking up a dead body. You would appreciate it if I told you that, right? Yeah. You grown. I'm 12. Don't you think there's some information I need to know? I'm not putting none of this together. We get to the house, people all in there crying. I'm not understanding what's going on. I'm trying to put it together. He's talking to the family. There's people outside, people inside. Everybody's upset. And I just notice that there's a lady in the chair asleep. I'm like, dang, this lady is sleeping her ass off. She don't know somebody done died. She is unbothered. You know, and then after a while, it just hit me. I'm like, oh my gosh. This lady ain't sleep, she is dead. Soon as I figure out what's going on, that's when my daddy turned around, looked at me and said, hey, grab her legs. Oh, Jesus, wait a minute. Grab her legs? Who gonna get mine? What are you talking about? So I got the muster up, you know. I get closer to the body. I'm inching towards her, you know. I'm trying to figure out, you know, okay, I got to do this. I can't tell him no because I'm scared of him. I'm inching towards, soon as I get this close to the body, I pass out. Just faint. Woke up in the back of the hearse with the dead woman. I wasn't conscious 10 seconds. Soon as I woke up, woke up again, still in the back of the hearse, but this time he had parked the hearse and the dead lady was gone. He took her and left me. So now I'm upset. I'm like, all right, I got to get out of here and find my daddy and try to figure out what's going on. So I find him here in the back. I'm like, father, did you put me on the stretcher with the dead woman? He looked me dead in my face and said, you damn right, I wasn't taking two trips for your ass. He said, now look, you need to make yourself useful, take out some trash or something. I ordered you some food. I just got you some chicken. But don't worry, it's just wings, because I see you ain't too far on the legs with your scary ass. Now, I'm going to touch on some politics before I get out of here. I'm about to go. Hope y'all enjoyed your little set. They were talking about Trump earlier in the event, you know, where I was at earlier today. And I just like to say, I didn't vote for Donald Trump. If anybody in here did, hey, that's your business. This is America. You had the freedom to do what you want to do. Just don't let us know. You might not make it out of here. But I didn't vote for him because he said too much stupid stuff during the campaign. That was it. Day one, I tried to give him a chance. But day one, he just came out and said, we're going to kick out all the Mexicans and build a wall. I like, let me get this straight. You're going to kick out everybody who actually know how to build a wall? I hope to hell you wasn't expecting us to get out there. Because I can tell you now, you better not give a bunch of black folks bricks and concrete, because that ain't going to make it to the border. I can tell you that now. But our houses will be immaculate. You be walking by what used to be the ghetto. Like, God, when did y'all build this up, man? I ain't never seen a 17-story double-wide trailer. When is it? But that isn't really why I didn't vote for him. I had a much more simple and a very shallow reason as to why I didn't vote for Trump. Very simple. I don't think you should be the president with your head looking like that. I'm sorry, you want to run the country, but you don't want to run a comb through your damn head. Because I'm sick of this. Every time I turn on CNN, you looking like you just got out of bed. You ain't got to represent me. And I want y'all to understand. Come with me into my mind. I feel like the hair is going to serve as a distraction at the UN meeting. You know, they be in the UN meeting, be kind of in a room like this, where all the world leaders get together and discuss how they're going to do international business. You know what I'm talking about. And he going to be up talking crazy, because that's what he do. It's going to be his turn to talk, and he's going to be up there talking out the side of his neck. But nobody can pay attention to nothing he's saying, because they all looking at his head. And you know one of them world leaders is going to have to say something. It's going to be an African, because they don't like to be uncomfortable for no long period of time. Because you know one of them African presidents is going to have their feel. It's going to be sitting there looking and just... You know what? This is crazy. I'm sorry, yes. To hell with it. I'm going to say something, yes. Yes, yes. Excuse me. You know, I'm sorry, but for the last 30 or 45 minutes, I have been trying to pay attention. to whatever you have been trying to say. But I cannot, I swear, no. It is how you say in your country, there is an elephant in the room. Tell me, what the hell is this hair on your head? I need to know. Explain to me, how is it that the hair on the back of your head can somehow reach all the way? To the front of your head, didn't go around. Hey, listen, y'all love God, love yourself, love each other. I'm Shula King, be good.
What's the matter, DJ? You only got one record or you got mad? He laughing so hard, he forgot to play. Oh, my God. Shula is crazy. We got more for y'all. We got some seats, gentlemen, if y'all want to sit down. Some men don't want to sit down. They want to mess the crease up. You tell when they sharp. Nah, I'm going to just chill right here. Oh, my God. It's the funniest thing when you see men who don't want to laugh come to a comedy show. They be angry because the woman, y'all make your husbands come. Every comedy show I'm at, you will see one angry dude. You ain't laughing at nothing. Women be dying laughing. All of a sudden, you see the man laugh, but he trying to hold it in. Yo. Yo, this dude good, man. Ooh. Yeah. Yeah. Still trying to be hard. We need to let hard go. Yeah, love each other. Just say hi, brother. Who made up that thug stuff anyway? I know we angry, but we ain't got to be angry all the time. Nobody wakes up angry every day. You got to smile sometime. If you can't smile at your woman, something ain't right. You can just wake up and you see your woman, because women do things to make you smile in the morning. Even that little bonnet on the side. You want breakfast, baby? You be like, yo, you crazy. Those are love signals. We gonna keep it going. You ready, DJ? You up there? Everything bright and shining, but you ain't pressed one button. You got all the equipment up there. We the best. At what? Not playing nothing? He got mad because he called you so-and-so. That ain't my name. That ain't my name. I'm Ziggle Ziggle. Oh, my God. This next brother, this is my partner in crime right here. Man, we are actually on tour together. He's one of the New York Kings. I love this guy to death, man. I hate to say it, but he reminds me of myself, but he's Latin. Everybody says our energy is the same. I'm getting older now, I done calmed down. It's gonna catch up to him too. Because you can have all these energies, but a couple of plane rides slow you down. And you all right? How you try to sneak? Not you, him. He too big to be tippy-toeing. He got strong tippy-toe. Bam, bam. You're gonna sneak big as you are. All right, let's keep it going. Come on, mama, hurry up, sit down. About to bring the next comedian. You know where you want everybody to see your little outfit. Come on, we was waiting for you. Don't come hugging everybody, sit down. Gonna come in late and act like this her show. How y'all doing? I was in the bathroom. Y'all right now? Okay, we good, let's go. I could tell when somebody doodled that little walk. Thank you, baby girl, you shouldn't have came late. Please put your hands together. When he's with us, the New York Kings, we call him the Latin Assassin.
Please put your hands together for Mr. Mark Vieira.
Here we go, here we go, y'all. Come on, make some noise. We can do better than that. Cut it, DJ. Let's go to work. How we doing, everybody? We good? Give it up for Shula King one time. My first time ever seeing him. Funny dude. Capone. How's everybody? I always ask where the beautiful ladies. Beautiful ladies, make some noise. Beautiful ladies. Okay. Some of y'all didn't say anything. We all right? We good? Hey, you ask that question. You expect the room to explode. Women never do it. Never. They never. Well, beautiful ladies, no. No. My stomach hurts. So bloated. Since yesterday, I ate 3 meals, 4 grapes. That's my wife. I say that because I'm married a long time. Women are a little crazy to me. I know because I have one in my house. <laughs> 23 years, that's a long time to be married to a human being, I promise you. You don't gotta clap. You don't know what I'm going through. You okay, Mark? I don't know, man. I'm trying to figure it out. My son is here. I'm grateful he doesn't have his phone with him. Right? Teenagers with their phones will drive you crazy. Am I right or wrong? Like, teenagers with their phones will drive you crazy, man. You talk to them, they just staring at the right. And some of it is my fault, right? I bought him the headphones, the big headphones. For Christmas, the big, you know, the Beats. DJ headphones, he's not a DJ. Noise canceling, right on the box. Noise canceling headphones. And I realized I'm the noise. This is everything you say, huh? Did you walk the dog, huh? Did you do, huh? They don't hear nothing you saying. I'm so grateful, man, that I have a cell phone, but I speak honestly when I say I don't love my cell phone. I put it down quite a bit. I use it for my business. I work. I have the apps. I have the social media. I have everything, but I love to put my cell phone down. I hate to, you know, you see, right? The kids don't know how to do that. They just got it. Always, it's always, they text you from within the same house. Bro, just get up and talk to me, man. Just know they text dad, what's for dinner? They right in the next room. I'm not from that time. I'm from a different time, y'all. I had a beeper in my lifetime. I don't mean I owned a beeper. I don't mean I owned, I lived the beeper life. Do you understand what I'm talking about? When the beeper first came out and it was a status symbol. Remember when the beeper came out and it was a status symbol? It meant you had business to take care of and you got that beeper and you tucked in your shirt like this here. And you had that beeper right here. You was walking in the neighborhood like, yeah, yeah, yeah. The beeper life, oh my. He was calling, hey, Mikey. Mike, hit me up on the beep. I'm here. The beep of life. Simple. It was a lot simpler. Simple life. No cell phone. When there was a beeper, when you lived the beeper life, there was no cell phone. You had a beeper and you had change. Why? Because there was a working payphone on every corner in every neighborhood. You had to have change. $7, $8. Quarters, nickels, and dimes in your pocket. And people can hear you coming. Shh. 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 Hey, Mark, you gonna do that laundry? No, I gotta make a couple phone calls. I'll be back. The beep of life. My payphone on my block rang back. You could accept calls. That meant if you were outside near that phone, you were the neighborhood secretary. Right? That phone rang, you were like, I got it. Hello? Who you looking for? Mike? Big Mike? Yeah, I got you. Hold on a second. Big Mike! You got a call, baby. Big Mike came down in his underwears and a robe. Yo, good looking out, baby. I needed that call. The beep of life. Now the cell phones with all the apps. Facebook. The other day, somebody told me this true story. Hey, Mark, hit me up on WhatsApp. I said, what's that? What? What are you talking about? Hit you. I gotta download an app just to mess with you? Brother, just call me on my phone, man. I'll give you my number. I'm not gonna download an app for you. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snap, right? Snapchat, it's a new one. I try not to mess with those ones too much. A Snapchat, for business, for me, man. Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook will mess you up. Facebook. Don't listen to Facebook. That's a trap. Facebook, every day you wake up, wish Joanna a happy birthday. Facebook be trying to get you. Go ahead, wish Joanna. It's Joanna's, wish Joanna a happy birthday. If you married, go ahead and wish Joanna a happy birthday. See what happened. Go ahead, do it. Oh, I've been there. My wife will wake up, babe, come here, let me ask. Because if you married, you know, that's one of the scariest things I ever heard in my life is this right here. Babe, let me ask you something. Come here. Am I right or wrong? Fellas, am I right? If you married, you know what I'm talking. Come here, let me ask you. Because when a woman asks you a question, that's because she already know the answer and she asking you for entertainment purposes only. You know this because everything you say, she go, oh, you think I'm stupid? You must think I'm stupid. Babe, come here, let me ask you something. You know Joanna? That you so happy it's her birthday? No, you real happy. You real happy is Joanna. You sent her 2 cakes and a balloon? Oh, you happy? What are you talking? That's an emoji. What are you saying? Because you got to send her 2 cakes. What? What are you doing? Don't let Facebook, don't let get you in a trap, man. They will get you. Instagram is no better. I'm in public's eye. I have to take pictures. I take pictures all the time. And Instagram, if you don't know, is all photograph. But people can tag you. People can tag. They can take a pen, they can tag you. I was on the phone with Instagram the other day. About 11:30, I said, hello, excuse me, Instagram. How do you untag this? Because she's gonna wake up in a few minutes. And when she wake up, I'm not going to make it. The girl went to me in the picture, then she tagged me. You can't untag it. I've tried everything. And you marry you. Oh, man, it's scary out there, man. Regular pictures get misconstrued, right? Because I'm telling you, I'm a victim sometimes. I took a picture with a young lady, and it was a regular picture. When I say regular picture, I mean a regular picture, right? Y'all know what regular, this is a regular picture right here, look. This young lady tagged me in the picture. She went and wrote a whole paragraph. And with every sentence, I was like this, oh my, Fellas, you ever feel the heat come on you? Well, you like, oh God. When this woman read this little message here, she wrote, you're my favorite comedian. I love you. I'ma come to all your shows. Any city you go in, I'ma be there. Then she put about five of those little heart eye emojis. Look. Hello, Instagram. You gotta take it down. You gotta She's Puerto Rican, she's gonna kill me. You don't understand what happened. I'm a good dude. I tell people the truth, man. I'm caught in the middle of enjoying the fans, right? Because fans are, I can't do what I do without the fans. I don't know what to do or say. She wrote a whole paragraph. I wrote back, thank you. So I replied, thank you so much. You hear it? You hear the women? You hear this? The men are like, you're a good brother. Go ahead and say it, baby. Go ahead. You see? That's what I said. I said, thank you for coming to the show. You look great. I appreciate. Why are you still breathing, though? Like, why are you? See, and I knew, this fellas, I went to sleep clear-hearted, I didn't do anything wrong. I wake up, the wife, I wake up at 7 a.m., she's dressed already. I said, oh, God. Babe, come here, let me ask you something. Come here, I want to ask you, you know this bitch? You know her, that she looks great? Really? Oh, that's what you, oh, now women look, oh, now you Tony the Tiger? That women look great? Really? You out here giving women cereal? Is that what you do? I'm like, what? I don't even have cereal. I don't have cereal. Why would you say that? I love her. I don't understand, man. It's funny you say 20. Anybody married a long time beside me? Long time. Anybody? How long y'all got? What you got? 38 years. God bless you, man. That's amazing. 38. What's the secret to 38, if you don't mind me asking? Secret to 38? For those in the back, he just went... Listen, I'm gonna be honest. I'm like him. I love my wife. I have no clue what keeps. We just every day be like, we gonna do it again. Every day, hey, we gonna do it this again because. I love her. I don't understand women. Through her, I don't really get y'all, man. She's so beautiful. To me, she's so perfect. Fellas, am I right or wrong? She's so perfect to me. I don't want to change nothing on her. That's not how she feels, though. 62 outfits. Right? Before they go out, 62 outfits. I don't know which one because... I don't have patience. That's what I can tell you. 23, I got no more patience. When I'm ready, I want to go. I didn't pay to see the fashion show. Fellas, am I right? The whole fashion show. Baby. Babe, how do I look late? You look late. We had to... Yeah. That's how every man looks on the way out the house. You look, come on. You better come on now. I've never been happy walking out the house. I've never been like, come on, let's go. Never. I always walk out the house like this. You know what? I'm mad at myself. I'm like, this is ridiculous. There are no rules, right? It doesn't matter who way you're going. We went to a wedding. We went to my cousin's wedding. Never been married before. He's getting married for the first time. It was a big deal for our family. Wow, Abe's getting married, man. It wasn't. When a woman goes to a wedding, it's not about them getting married. It's about how she looks at that wedding. Am I right or wrong? Women, they don't. My wife was like, Abe's getting married. She was like, babe, I gotta get dressed. We're gonna look the same. You're gonna wear a purple shirt. I'm gonna wear the purple dress in the closet. The purple dress was like this big. And when she bought that purple dress, she said a lie. She said to me, baby, I know the dress looks small. No, this was, I'm not lying to you. She looked me in my face. She said, baby, I know the dress looks small, but that's okay. Because I start my diet on Monday. I said, it's Tuesday. You gonna wait 6 days. The wedding is right around the corner, babe. You, that dress is so small. I knew it. I said, this is gonna be a problem. I had my nice purple shirt ready. And she was putting on that purple dress the day of the wedding. And I could hear noise, man. She was it's not funny. She was making a sound. I said, what the hell? I love my wife. I'm concerned. I go in her closet and I push the door and the dress was stuck right here. And she, women do not, they don't stop, man. She walking in the closet, you know, doing this thing here. I don't even know what you call it. Look. And the dress was fighting her back, man. The dress was like, we ain't doing this right now, you know? And she didn't stop. No, you're going to fit tonight because Abe is getting married tonight and you're going to come up. Fellas, I don't know. I'm not sure if you've ever watched your woman get dressed before. It can be hilarious. Because I laughed for about 15 minutes, and I realized the wedding was at 7. We're from New York. You gotta account for that traffic. Right, fellas, you know how we do. We start counting down the seconds. If we don't leave by such and such, we're not going. I said, baby, we got to leave, right? To make it on, we got to leave now. Please. Just put something on that fits. Her face. Oh, you don't think it fits? Is that what you think? You know why you think that? Because you stupid, that's why. Believe me, it fits. She took the dress off, threw it on the ground. She went back deeper in the closet. She put on something I've never seen before. It's not funny. When, fellas, if you don't know, let me explain. When you're married a long time, you see things you're not supposed to see, man. She went deep in the closet and she pulled out the suit, this thing that women are wearing underneath the clothes. No, it's not funny. What did you say? The Spanx. Latinos, we call it the faja. The Spanx. And if you've never seen the Spanx, if you have no... This shit has legs. It's not funny. I never seen it. It got legs and arms. And it's so tight. It's so... She came out of the closet. Look. She looked like a T-Rex. She was making a sound. Look. Ooh. Ooh. I said, What noise? This is how you know we're married a long time. She didn't even acknowledge me. She walked right past me. She picked up the dress that didn't fit just seconds ago. Guess what? It fit. It was like a magic trick. The damn thing, I saw it with my own face. It didn't fit. Then she put the suit with the opening. I don't know how it has the open. I don't know, fellas. It's a whole suit. All this shit missing here. This whole thing. The dress didn't like that. Look, the dress, she did. She looking right at me. Look. The dress goes right on. There she looks at me. She walks over to me. She said, babe, can you help me zip this? I didn't know how to tell her that the zipper was this far apart. I'm looking at the zipper like, how am I supposed to do this? How? The zipper is looking at me like this. Look, wait. No. If you can't zip it, whose fault is it? It's your fault. I tried zipping that zipper for about 20. My fingers were bleeding. She looks at me, what's wrong with you? Why can't you zip? What do you go to the gym for if you can't even zip shit in this? Like I'm in the gym doing this right here. Like when not natural. You've seen, right? If you've been with your, and they got the suit underneath, it's amazing. Look, I don't know who makes the suit. I heard a woman created it. God bless the the Spanx suit. Is that what it is? And the dress fit so incredible that she was a different woman. We got to the wedding. You would think it was her wedding. She walked ahead of me. Do you understand what I'm saying? We get to the wedding. She walking in front of me, throwing stuff around. Everybody's like, oh, my God, you look great. I'm like, she's lying. She's like, that's a lie. There's a suit with the, and it has a hole. I don't know why there's a hole, but it's a suit. She was walking like that before, but now she fixed it. You know? Women support, right? Women, when they see other, they're like, girl, what you doing? I'm like, I wish I could tell you, but she would kill me. I tell young dudes, I always tell my young friends, man, if you're dating, man, if anybody in here is dating, listen to me. Listen to me. Married 23 years. This man's 38 years in. Let me say this to you. Stay right there. Dating is so beautiful. When you're married and you see people dating, you stop and go, yeah. Because when you date, you do things. You have liberties that married people just can't take, man. Like dropping somebody off at the end of the night. I haven't dropped someone off. Listen to me when I say this to you. I haven't dropped someone off at the end of, for 20 plus years have I. When that little piece, right, I miss. When I watch a young man drop a young lady off, I'm like, go ahead, brother, do that, right? Because he gets to the house and he's like, thank you so much. I had a great time. Yeah, I'm going to call you later, okay? He just disappears. Oh, my God. Are you married? They follow you all the way back to the house. And they get undressed in front of you. Let me explain. When you're married a long time, they don't even care no more, man. Man, we got home from that wedding. I'm taking my little suit off. And my wife hit the eject button on that. I don't know how you get out. I'm trying to tell you. I don't know how you get out of the Spanx, but she hit a button and that thing blew open. Listen to me. Everything came out at one time. You ever open a can of biscuits on a Sunday morning and that? Just wapow! Everything way. Your boob just hit my arm. Chill. When you're dating, it's different, man. I'm going to hang my jacket neatly on that note. When you're dating, it's different. When you're married, you got to play it cool. When you date, you do stuff. It's spontaneous. You understand? Something starts in the car, it could finish right in the car. Because that's dating spontaneity. When you're married and you got kids, that ain't gonna happen. I love my boys with every fiber of my humanity. I love my sons. But they mess up. Me and my wife love making life. Because of these two jerks. Because I don't know about you, but I know my boys, the second we start touching, they start acting up, you know, Daddy! Leave me alone. Nobody told me that. Date, you make love, it's spontaneous, it's fun, let's do it, yeah. It's noise, yeah. When you're married and you got kids, you gotta sneak around in your own house. The house I'm paying for. We make love, we are like two ninjas. I'm telling you the truth, me and my wife want some intimate time. We are like SEAL Team 6. We operate under the cover of darkness and complete silence. This is us trying to get it. Look, look. Psst, psst, psst. I call it shh loving. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Shh, loving when you got kids in the house. Women don't want all that. I know for a fact. Women don't want their kids hearing all that mess. The whole time you're in the bedroom, shh, he's right there. Shut up. Stop. Right, the both of you like this, look. Okay, go. kids don't care neither, right? Kids be under the door. Dad! I can't see your feet, Daddy. Where are you? Man, you better leave me alone! It's the worst. Ninja sex. I have mastered the art of ninja sex. I've caught myself. You ever close the door in the bedroom? My wife's like, babe, come here. I'm like, oh, it's time to go. And you close the door. You ever see how you close the door? Like that, look. You don't hear it. The door go. And you hold the doorknob till the door is completely shut. Then you release the doorknob ever so slightly. Because if kids hear that door close, right, it's like an invitation for them to come and knock until, and kids don't knock and leave. They Market call me stupid. I'm calling you stupid. Because I ain't opening this door. Not right now. It ain't going to happen. I'm from the Bronx, New York. Any New Yorkers in the house? New Yorkers in the house? Summer's over for us in New York, man. Kids back on school buses, roadways. I tell people the truth. I'm an old school Bronx kid with a little Puerto Rican grandmother that I love more than anything. Little thing about this big. Spent her whole summer in New York City on the windowsill with her pillow perched, and she would yell from the fifth floor, excuse me, don't park your car over there. You're going to get a ticket. And you already got three, $35. Stupid. Excuse me, pay your rent 4 months. You don't pay. Nobody can live for free. That's all I'm saying. Grandmothers ain't like that no more. Grandmothers are not like that no more. Like my grandmother who wore a house dress all day. Grandmothers ain't like that no more. Grandmothers are on Instagram now looking good, right? I got one on my Instagram, sexy grandma, 1, 2, 3, gorgeous. She just came from Cancun, look. Whose grandmother's this? My grandmother always wore a house dress. If you don't know what I'm talking about, I had the little snaps going down the front with them two little pockets. My grandmother did two things all day long. She watched the Spanish soap operas and the news. She flip-flopped those two things all day if she was home. The news, the novelas, the news. But she was so overdramatic with her shows, like her programs. When my grandmother watched the novela, she was crying. It's always something dramatic. Ay, ay, Dios mío, Jorge, don't die. Jorge's gonna die today, please. I'd come in from outside, I'm like, Ma, what happened? What happened to Jorge? No, from the novela, he's gonna die. They're gonna shoot him today. Ay. If my grandmother wasn't watching the novela, she was watching the news. This is the difference. My little Puerto Rican grandmother watched the Spanish news. Not like me. I'm a very simple dude. I watch eyewitness news. 20-something minutes, guess what? I witnessed something. Get the news. My grandmother watched the Spanish news. It's called Primer Impacto. If you've never seen it before, let me explain. It's the most gangster news on TV. You can tell because the reporter gets there while the crime is still in progress. This brother does not play. He is out there. Hola, this is Juan Rivera. Mira, they're coming out. They're coming out. He's still trying to get a story. Why you do that? What happened? I saw him interview a dead guy. I've never, on any other news, he's standing over to the mirror. How you die? What happened? He don't speak English, this guy. Yo, you guys have been great. Thank you so very much for having me this year. Thank you.
Yeah. We got one more. I got a gift for somebody that I have to give you. It's Mattis Cole Clive from Florida. If you're here, raise your hand. I hope I'm saying your name right. M-A-T-T-I-S. Mattis. Are you here? No? You don't want your prize? Mattis Cole Clive from Florida. Okay. I guess we'll try later and see where he's at. We got a prize for him. All right. Can y'all hang for one more? Y'all don't sound like it. Can y'all hang for one more? Yeah. This brother here is funny. I mean, everybody's funny, but I love watching him. He's a different kind of comedian that has jokes to make you think. Now, that's an intelligent comedian. Ain't too many of them out here. I can name a few. Him and Dave Chappelle. That's it. The rest of us is just goofy. This brother here is serious. So I need the energy. It's the last comedian. I don't know what we're doing after this, but you got to laugh. So let's have some fun. And if y'all know Mattis Clive, I think he would want to see me because he going to be in trouble if he don't have this. That's all I'm going to say. So ladies and gentlemen, our last comedian for tonight. What I got to say about him? Producer, actor. Man, this brother here has an Emmy from Comedy Central and an NAACP award. Winning from The Daily Show with my man Trevor Noah, all the way from Alabama. He's a country boy. I need that energy. I need that energy. Let's clap it up for comedian Roy Wood Jr.
Thank you, DJ. Thank you, DJ. Let's turn it off. I don't know which way the hurricane going. I gotta hurry up. I don't know. That was nice of Capone. I appreciate that, Capone. You say I'm smart and everything, but I'm going to keep it real with y'all. Some of y'all know the truth about me. It took me 5 years to get out of Florida A&M. 5 years. That ain't smart. Yeah, a couple other folks. Exactly. Don't let nobody make you feel bad because it took you 5 years to get out of college. You ain't going to make me feel bad. All they put on the degree is what day you finish. They don't put what day you start. That's all that matters. Finish it. Got to pay back all these student loans. Clap if you got student loans. Who in here dealing with all the student loans? You know what's messed up about student loans? I owe all the student loan money. I graduated with a 2.5. I didn't learn everything. Why I got to pay you for stuff I don't remember? That's my question. If a class costs $500, I make a C. All I owe you is $250. That's all I'm saying. Get in, get out. It's been a good week. Clap if you had the Popeye's chicken sandwich. Did you have the Popeye's chicken sandwich? Three people. Clap if you fought somebody for a Popeye's chicken sandwich. You seen the people, you seen the videos. Black people done lost their damn mind over a chicken sandwich. But I get it though, man. I like fast food. I'm embarrassed to say it, but I like it. I eat it all. I like McNuggets. I'm a grown man. I still eat McDonald's. Okay, no, me and one other brother. Everybody else acting all bougie now. They eat hummus. You and me, we're the only two still get them nuggets and be counting your nuggets before you leave, too. This how you know McDonald's. This how you know Chicken McNuggets good. McDonald's came out with a commercial a couple years ago. They said, our nuggets are now all white meat. What the hell have you been feeding us up until now? And nobody asked a single question. I like the McNugget. I still eat the McRib. All right, y'all ain't with me on none of this food stuff, all right? I like the McRib, man. I respect the McRib. I like the McRib because McDonald's don't tell you nothing about it in the commercial. You know how gangster you got to be to not say nothing about the sandwich in the commercial? McRib commercial been the same for 40 years. It's back. The hell is it? What kind of meat is that? Is it square? Mm-hmm. It's back.
would you like one or not? Love food. Love fast food because it's easy to sneak into movies. Anybody else doing that? Anybody else? I'm grown. I don't care. I still sneak food in the movies. You got to catch me. Let's be real about sneaking food in the movies. First off, it's not illegal. You ain't committing a crime. Ain't no damn dog sitting there. Ain't no TSA sniffing bomb dog to detect the chicken wing. Put that thing in your pocket and walk. That's how you get the food in the movies. You put a Baconator under your arm. You lock that arm and you just move. And ladies, it's your job to help us. I don't know if you know that or not, but it's your job to help your man sneak the food in the movies. That's in the Bible. I know the scripture. That's 3 Corinthians. All right, some of the heathens in here didn't get that one. No, is that in the Bible? For real, it is. It's in the back. You got to write it. That's what the blank page is for. Ladies, you with your man, y'all go to the movies, you got to bring a big purse. Period. You don't bring a clutch bag on the movie night. That's selfish. You don't come downstairs with no clutch bag. You got to bring a satchel, something with a shoulder strap. Coming downstairs with this little clutch bag. Ain't this cute? Don't it match my shoes? It don't match the Cheesecake Factory in the car. Trying to get these spring rolls in the movies. Clap if you're in a relationship. Who's in a relationship in here? Some of y'all? Me and my girl been together 5 years, got a 3-year-old. The one thing I wish people had told me about with relationships, and this is like, it's not until you get older and you're in a relationship that you realize all the stuff your parents forgot to tell you. I wish my father would have explained to me the concept of the damn thermostat in the house. Because once you lose that battle, fellas, it's a wrap. And that thermostat, that's serious stuff, man. The thermostat is serious. If you with somebody in here right now, y'all can't agree on what temperature to make the house, y'all ain't gonna make it as a couple. That's the more important stuff. But when you dating, your parents tell you all the wrong stuff to look for in people. They be telling you to look for somebody that's got spiritual guidance. Look for somebody that respects others. That ain't what you need. You need somebody you thermostatically compatible with. Religion ain't nothing. A Muslim can date a Christian, but an 82 can't date a 67. That ain't gonna never, you know the thermostat is a serious battle. Look in your car. In your car right now, you got 2 knobs for the damn air conditioner. Dual climate control. Because 2 people sitting 3 feet from each other can't agree on the temperature. That's how serious it is. Parents in the room, where the parents at? More importantly, fathers, where are the fathers in the room? Yeah. Got me a 3-year-old man and figuring that out. That's a whole nother situation. There was a brother earlier today, I was at Ed Gordon's talk about the myth of the absent black father. And a brother stood up in the session this afternoon and said something that just really resonated with me about how he didn't realize how angry he was at his father until he had a child. You start having this child and loving this child, and then you look back at the way your father treated you and you get angry for the first time, but you grown and you don't know what to do about it. Now this brother, his father's still living. My daddy died when I was 16, so I'm in a messed up situation where I can't even talk to him. Y'all believe in mediums? Okay, I'm the only person in here. Okay, we're gonna get real on the spiritual stuff for a second. Y'all don't believe in that? Y'all don't think you can talk to the dead? You don't think for $20 you can pull up your dead grandmama on Skype? See what's cracking up in heaven? Yo, I'll say this first. If talking to the dead is real, at minimum, it's rude. Let's just be honest about that. If somebody dead, the last thing they want is to be bothered with you and your earth problems. Leave them alone. The reason why I don't think talking to the dead is real is that every time I see it on TV, anytime you see somebody on TV talking to the dead, they be talking to them psychic people, it's always somebody that they love, somebody they missed, you know? I'm talking to the spirit. The spirit is here. What say you to the spirit? Ask him if he loves me. You don't never see nobody talk to the dead, somebody that they mad at. This is a true story. I got a homeboy that died. He owed me $637. And that's unfortunate. I'm sorry that he died. I went to the funeral, but there was still a piece of me that kind of wanted to go to a medium. I'm like, hey, who on earth got me that? I wouldn't mind that, man. It's just a different situation with my child, trying to figure out what things to instill in them, because some of those things were never instilled in me, you know? The thing that's really gripping that I really had to come to terms with as a parent is that your job above all things as a parent is to protect your child. And that's something that just as a single man with no kids, that never even crossed my mind. But then I had a kid, I live in New York where just, you know, people get punched in the face for no reason. So you just be walking down the street in New York, you just be looking at people at all times. And that's when it dawned on me. I'm like, yo, if something really went down, I got to die first. I got to protect this child. Which is fine, I understand that, because he's three. That's my job, to protect the infant. But my bigger question is, at what age is it okay to not die first anymore? Because I'm going to be honest with you, I don't think forever is the answer to that question. If I'm 80, I'm not dying for a 37-year-old man. Is you crazy? You a grown man. You saw the same thing coming I saw. Why didn't you step to the side, Henry? Get your ass out the way. Got to take him to church, get my son a good religious foundation, you know. Take my son to church, but when the faith healing start, I pull out the iPad so we can look down. Because I ain't quite sure how to explain that to my child yet. He's three, I don't know how to explain old people getting punched in the face. I don't know, you ever seen the faith healers on TV? This is my question to faith healers. I understand that it's for people and it works, but why faith healers got to be so rough? Like, why you gotta slap the hell out of something? Like, if you got the healing hand of Jesus, just caress me gently. Is that not a reasonable request of a faith healer? You ever seen the faith healers on TV? We in the South. People from the South know what I'm talking about. Jesus come on 24/7. They got the whole Jesus channel with the gold couches and Deion Sanders and Emmitt Smith talking to you. And them pastors be rough. And these are fragile people. I never understood why faith healers are so rough. These people are hobbling up on stage with their last drop of energy. They be getting up there. Pastor, I tried everything. I don't know what to do. Have you tried the foot of Jesus? I'm like, oh my God, he just kicked off the stage. Did you just kick this old lady off the stage? Oh, my Lord. Your other job as a parent is to be excited no matter what. No matter what. No matter what your kid do, it's your job to be excited, to encourage them so that they can constantly achieve more. Which is fine, I got no problem with it, but it's the best acting I've ever done in my life. My son is three, he can count to 46. That's his trick. That's all he can do, 46. 44, 45, 46. And I gotta sit there like a dummy. Yeah, good job, 46. But in the back of my head, I'm like, I'm grown. I know all the numbers, so I'm not impressed. But you can't say that, because then he won't learn 47, 48. So you got to go, good job, you did it. We take our son to protest. We don't really play the front line of a lot of protests, but we just like for our son to just see seas of people that look like him, you know? Like from just for the atmosphere of it, we want him to see that stuff. And that's the one thing that I've really enjoyed about dating this wonderful black woman is that she not only cares about black people, she cares about all people. For the first time in my life, I started going to protests that ain't got nothing to do with black issues, which I should have been doing all along. I'll tell you something, black people. You want to do something dope? Go to a protest that ain't got nothing to do with you. I was in New York. We went to a Muslim ban protest. I'm not Muslim. This issue does not affect me. But to go there and stand tall with other people, it was an amazing feeling to see other people on the right side of an issue fighting for what's right. This is the best thing about going to a protest that ain't got nothing to do with you. You can just leave whenever you want. I'm from Birmingham. When you go to a protest, you at the protest. You don't get to leave. You better pack a snack. Because that's the thing they don't tell you about black protests. Anybody in this room that's protest with black people, it's a long-ass day, isn't it? You don't just get to walk off. I was at the Muslim protest. I left. I was like, I stayed out there 3-4 hours. I said, hey, man, y'all stay strong. I got to get to work in the morning. Good luck, travel ban. I'll see y'all later. You be at a black protest. I tried to sneak off. I took 2 steps away from the group. They said, where you going, brother? The struggle is this way. My bad. That's my bad. You see the struggle ain't this way? Without looking at the GPS, I thought the struggle was, okay, we can go this way. We can go this way. White people be at the protest now. That's dope. White people be serious, man. Let's go. Let's get them. Let's go. Had a white friend send me an email. Hey, Roy, we're marching for the issues. It's a 10-day march. We're marching for 10 days. We're going to march all the way to D.C. for 10 days. Are you with us? I said, no, I am not. I'm not going nowhere for 10 days. I'm just going to walk with you in the woods for 10 days. And what the hell make you think any black person got 10 vacation days to burn? Just walking. We ain't got no 10 days. Black people ain't never had 10 days to protest. Even back in the day, if you look at most of the iconic moments in black history, it's 2-3 days. Get in, get out, get your ass home so you can keep your job. Million Man March was a couple days. Selma to Montgomery, that march was a couple days. Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech, the iconic I Have a Dream. The March on Washington, it was a Thursday. It was one damn day. That's for real. You look at the photos of the March on Washington. You see that sea of black folks? It was a work day. It was one day. Dr. King did one show. He didn't even do two shows. He did a matinee, and he bounced. Because folks had to get home. I have a dream, the mountaintop. We're going to get to the mountaintop one day in a month. All right, we got to roll. Let's get it, Abernathy. It's just dope to see how blackness is being represented now, you know. And it's honest, too. That's why I like the way that they're portraying black superheroes on TV now. It's dope. It's really dope how to present black superheroes. Because it's honest. Most black superheroes ain't got time to save the world. That's one of the most honest things I've ever seen on television and in movies. Most black superheroes ain't like, because when you really think about it, just the idea of saving the world, that's some area, like you just gotta, everything gotta really be good in your hood for you to just go, I have powers, what's happening over here? Most black superheroes, they ain't worried about the world, they gotta focus on their hood. They ain't got time, it's too many issues affecting the black community. You can't worry about the world, you gotta fix your people first. I watched this show, Luke Cage. Y'all seen Luke Cage on Netflix? Yo. Prime example, what I'm talking about. Luke Cage is a beautiful show. Luke Cage, if you've never seen it, it's about a brother, superpowers, hoodie, bulletproof, super strength, all that. With that resume, he should be somewhere with Iron Man out in the galaxy saving the world. Luke Cage never leaves Harlem. That's respect. Like, ain't, don't care about nothing else. And, but he went to Brooklyn one time to fight a Jamaican. That was it. Any other time, Luke Cage is in Harlem. He don't care about nobody else. Until Thanos cross 125th, it ain't his problem. It's not that black people don't care about the world. It's just that we don't have the time. We ain't got the time to worry about what everybody else going through. We got to fix ourselves. Look at Black Panther. That's what the whole movie Black Panther was about. It was about whether or not to work on yourself or work on the whole world. Black Panther had to get his ass whooped by his cousin before he would even consider it. Thank you, Capone. Killmonger had to beat Black Panther's face in. Hey, man, our people getting oppressed. Go on, give me some of them Wakanda weapons so we can go free them. And Black Panther was like, no, Wakanda. That's what we do, Wakanda. No, but you don't understand. There's people who look just like you and me. They out there, and they getting oppressed. These weapons, free the people. No, Wakanda. And then Killmonger was like, stop up! I have reconsidered my position as you have whooped my ass in ritual combat. Why do you think you don't see Samuel L. Jackson to the end of every Avengers movie? Yeah, he busy. He off doing black stuff. Any of all the Marvel movies you can name, Sam Jackson, all you see is him at the very beginning of the movie. All right, y'all, listen up. There you go. You better get him. And then he come back at the end of the movie. Good job. You got him. Way to go. You got him. All right, I got to go to a protest. Come on, white lady. We got to get out there. I'll end with a story that I hope makes a little bit of sense. It's a lesson that I learned while I was at Florida A&M University up in Tallahassee. A couple of rattlers out there, a couple of y'all. Good to see y'all. Just give me a little money on that student loan and we good. I always say that I grew up in Birmingham, but I feel like I became a man in Tallahassee because a lot of the mistakes that I made. And I think mistakes, if you let them, they can ruin you, but if done rightly with the right people around you, they can uplift you and reinforce you and make you a better person. Best job I ever had in my life was Golden Corral. Don't hate, it was delicious. Anybody here? Y'all used to eat at the buffet? I keep forgetting, y'all got money. We excelling in here. This is... Y'all go to Whole Foods and get the hot plate. I forgot what I'm dealing with in here. This is black people who excel. You are beyond the buffet life now. You should have seen some of the noses that went up. Golden Corral? Well, I haven't been there since 93. But that was my job, man. Golden Corral, man. Golden Corral was a beautiful place. A restaurant job is dope because what you meet are people that are all on different points in their life journey. You got young people that you're working with. You got veterans you're working with. You got people in college like you. You got old heads who just doing it as a retirement job to get a side check. And you meet all of these different type of people. And because my father died when I was 16, there were a lot of black men at this Golden Corral. So without knowing it, you're picking up little pieces of manhood, little tips on how to treat people and how to be a person by just being in the atmosphere of black men that are trying to do the right thing, you know? I had a manager that always stressed being nice to people. And that was one of the biggest lessons that I learned. You know, it's like, no matter how somebody treats you, try your best to be nice for as long as they ain't disrespecting you. I go, okay, I don't think that's gonna get me no tips, but whatever. We had this dude that used to work the carving station. His name was Big Mix. And so I don't know, you know, anybody here that's been to one of these restaurants, one of these buffet spots that's got the brother that's slicing the meat, they be dedicated. Like, that's a job you have to earn. I don't even have to explain to you how many years you got to work in the back doing prep to earn the right to be the roast beef slicer on Sunday brunch. That's top notch. And Big Mix was not playing around. Big Mix would slice that meat and, how you doing, baby? He'd done 4 years in prison. I'll tell you something right now. There's nobody more focused on their job than a black man intent on not going back to jail. You ever want to be around a focused brother? Be around a brother who is done with that street life. That's all Big Mix talked about. Brother, I slice this meat and I do my job. Them white folks ain't gonna take me back. I tell you that right now. Them white folks try to get you. You better do your job, your blood. Go on, tuck your apron in. Get your ass back out there on the floor. I gotta slice this meat. Stop talking to me. White folks is watching. But Big Mix was focused. Uniform clean, crease, pressed, all that. Didn't matter what he was getting paid. He took the job seriously. And at this manager. And so there's this thing at Golden Corral called the 100 Club. And the 100 Club is a policy at Golden Corral where you have to learn the first name and two favorite menu items of 100 customers that come in the store. He's nodding, he knows exactly what to say. See, why you ain't clap when I asked about Golden Corral the first time? You left me hanging, you worked it, so you know what I'm talking about, this is a for real thing. And it sounds crazy, but if you learn two names a week, two foods a week, by the end of the year, it's just, I can't explain it, it's just some Rain Man thing happens to you. And you see the regulars come in the store and you just see them, you go, ham and chili, there he is, ham and chili. Hot tea, no lemon, hot tea, no lemon. You just learn everybody's menu item. And there was one dude whose name I could never find out because he would never speak. He was the rudest, most disrespectful, one of them big bodybuilding ass dudes, right? One of them big swoles. You ever seen them people that work at the vitamin shops look like they ate all the vitamins? You know what I'm saying? GNC, like they just talking breath. How you doing today, sir? And he always got the same thing. He'd walk through the line, he'd get the tray, set it down, go over to the carving station with Big Mix, get two whole rotisserie chickens, a piece of carrot cake, and a pitcher of water. And that was his thing. And I would serve him for a year and a half straight. I served this dude. He never spoke. He never said thank you. He never left a tip. Just the most negative experience you can name. But I always treated him with respect because that was the job and that's what the manager said do, so I do it. It got to the point where Muscle Man would come through the line and I would see him in line, so I would go over to Big Mix. I go, hey man, Vitamin Shop is in line. And Mix had already clocked him from the parking lot. The chicken was already on the plate. I told you, them white folks ain't gonna get me. Put it on this table. He liked the sauces too. It was a good job. So about a year later, I get arrested. I got arrested while I was in college for credit card fraud. I had a job at the post office. I don't know if y'all knew this or not, but like if your name ain't on the credit card, you're not supposed to use it. You know what I'm saying? I didn't know that. It's in the scripture. It's in 3 Corinthians, but I didn't double check it. But I ended up on probation, thankfully. But at the time, that was a scary thing. I'd never been arrested before. And I'm in jail, and it's too late for me to make a bail hearing, so they're going to keep me overnight. So I'm in processing, and I'm sitting there, and everybody's getting up in 10-minute intervals to do a mugshot, fingerprint. They change you out in your clothes. They do a medical exam on you, and then they send you off into the pod to go into your cell for the night, right? So people would go through this door, and they walk through, and then the other door would open, and as soon as they walked in the pod where the cells were, I just heard a dude go, "Aah!" Now, imagine never being in jail before. And you sitting there, and you just see people one by one go into a room and just hear, "Aah!" I get on the phone. I call my mama. I call 911. That's not even her number. And I thought that'd be the quickest way to call it. It's just like, this is the jail. You can't, there's no emergency. Hang up, sir. So it's my turn to go through the doors into the pod. And as I walk in, there's 24 pods, there's 24 cells low, and there's 24 cells high. And I take my first step into what I assume is going to be the end of my life. And I just hear this dude down low. I hear this dude go, "Hey!" I take my second step. And I'm trying to ignore him. I'm trying to keep my head low. But he is not talking to me. "Hey! Hey, boy! You the one been fighting my mama?" Now, that's how he started the conversation. That's his icebreaker. Is accusing me of fighting his mama. Now, I do not know this man. I do not know this man at all. But now I'm being accused of another crime that I didn't, well, I did the first one. But this one, I didn't do this crime. "You see me over here, boy? You the one been fighting my mama?" And I turn to the guard. I go, "Sir, what is the situation with this gentleman in cell 7? And he goes, "Oh, he caught word that his mother was in a domestic dispute today, and he knows that the man who got in a fight with his mom was arrested today, but he doesn't know what the man looks like, so he assumes that anyone that comes in this pod is the man who fought his mother. So his plan in the morning at breakfast is to fight all of y'all." It's 10:30 at night. I ain't even got all my jail supplies yet. And I have an appointment for an ass whooping in the morning. Already, there's an ass whooping at 7:30 a.m. Get ready. And I'm trembling. I'm like 250 now. At the time, I was 175 pounds, same height. So I'm stick thin. It's going to be an easy fade for him. So I try to man up what little courage I got, and I look over at cell 7, and I go, "I do not know your mother, sir." Which I should have been just better off saying nothing. I should have said nothing. And he starts snarling, and he starts punching the glass, like legit, like full Mike Tyson, like breaking his... you the one been fighting my mama? And he bangs on the wall. Sweetie! Sweetie! And I hear a voice up top, pod 30. What up? Smitty, come to the glass. Come to the glass, look at this boy, and tell me he ain't the one that's been fighting my mama. And I look up at pod 30, and I can't make him out because of the light. And it's a silhouette of a man, and he's looking. And you see the silhouette do this. And then you hear him go, nah, he cool. He used to hook me up with the chickens at Golden Corral. So always be nice to people because you don't know when you're going to see them again. Good night. Thank y'all a lot, man.
Cut that, young. I don't know how kids still breathe after all of that. These kids ain't doing nothing but stealing our mama dances. All that. That's a mama dance. Remember when you told your mother, told you get up, go get dressed, and you still was there? I said, get up. Don't talk back to me. Well, that's the end of the show. Am I bringing the guys back up? Yes, okay. I want to bring them back up. But before I do, I want to take this time to sell my shirts. Because if I don't sell my shirts, then my account won't be right. So I have two shirts tonight that I'm going to sell. One y'all familiar with. Even though I got three different ones, but two ones are really important to me and you. And ladies, if you with a man tonight and he don't buy you a shirt, it's like no future with him. Everybody who knows me know I grew up in the hood and I'm a mama's boy. And my mother was the one who told me, you gotta make something of yourself. Because when you're in the hood, the one thing you always hear is you're not gonna be nothing. And when you see crowds like this, and I'm not trying to make a long speech, but this is something that's very serious. Because Isaiah Thomas touched on it earlier. The one thing about helping each other out is the biggest thing where somebody said, you have control of your money. And I heard him say that today. But we seem to let our money be controlled by other people. We support everybody, and we find it hard to support ourselves. I don't understand it, because anybody who is selling something, we all know what it takes that we go through. In helping each other, the one thing that my mother did was help me, because when you hear all the time, boy, you ain't gonna grow up to be shit. And oh, I know some of us heard it. And so for me to have my shirt to say, because my mother's no longer here, but I carry her name, it just says, Mama, we made it. And my second shirt, it means more to me because the one thing that I seen, and I have to say this, I saw a black woman with a shirt that said, kiss me, I'm Irish. And that really puzzled me. I don't have a racist bone in my body, but there is a problem where everybody has a culture that we support. Kiss me, I'm Irish. All kinds of other races, or race that I say. But there's nothing to represent what a queen looked like. And to me, my mother was a queen. So I created a shirt for black queens. And it's nothing more than a woman with an afro. And it's a powerful message of bringing back the essence of what black power is all about. And if I can make a difference by making somebody or seeing somebody in this shirt, it will definitely, definitely let me know that my message is being put out there. And sometimes it's not about the money, but sometimes it is. But what's most important, what's more important to me than anything is showing that our culture is strong, because the one thing I'm gonna say before I get out of here, they're hating on us for some reason. And if we don't understand why, we need to take a deeper look than ourselves. So let me bring out these comedians who entertain tonight, and I hope you enjoy them to the fullest. Mr. Shula King, please come out. I know he's out there trying to sell his shirts. He's not back here. Mark Vieira, come out. Roy Wood Jr., come out. And I don't want to...
The gangsta of comedy, Capone. Give it up for your host tonight, Capone.
Black Enterprise, I can't thank you enough for giving me this opportunity. The one thing about a comedian is you can talk all you want to, but when you got nobody to talk to, it's a lonely world. So when you invite us to come out and do this thing and show our craft to make people laugh, because you know black people, Roy said it, it's hard to make black people laugh. Y'all look for every reason not to laugh. Nah, I don't like the way his shoe. So I know Butch usually come up. Brother, you don't understand how much I appreciate you and what you have continued, because I got kids, and what your father started is something that's incredible to us, and you picking it up and taking it to the level that you're taking it to, I just commend you as a man to say thank you. Thank you. Yeah. I want to bring two of my comedian friends out that wasn't even on the show. Flex, come out. Where Flex at? Come out. Flex Alexander, y'all. Chris Spencer. Avion Crockett. Now, let me tell you something. It takes a lot to be backstage and see all of these people and not touch the mic. And these brothers just sat back there and said, y'all go do y'all thing. These are our comrades in comedy, just coming out to show love. Thank y'all. I don't know what we're doing, but I know we're going to be doing something. Cigars? Yeah. Oh, cigars. I don't smoke, but I know some ladies do. Thank y'all so much. God bless y'all, and good night.